Hello, and welcome to Insider Insights. I'm Anne Meisinger, Assistant Educator in Public Programs and Creative Practice at the Met. And you just heard our speaker for this program, Curator in the Department of Musical Instruments, Bradley Strauschenscher, playing the natural horn in our galleries last February. In this virtual series, we take a closer look at objects in the Met collection and in our special exhibitions. This year marks the 250th birthday of the composer Ludwig van Beethoven, and I am so pleased that Bradley could join us today to talk about his life. Bradley will be sharing some insights on the art, politics, and musical instruments that shaped Beethoven's world and his music. Bradley, thank you so much for being with us today. I am really looking forward to delving into Beethoven's world with you.
Thank you, Anne. I think I'd better begin with a bit of a confession. When you and I first started talking about this project, it made me realize that I've always felt a bit daunted by Beethoven, both as a musician and as an academic, because he's such a colossal figure in the world of music and ideas. Indeed, it makes me think of Franz Schubert, a brilliant composer who, in a sense, had the misfortune of being alive during Beethoven's lifetime. And he must have felt a bit in the shade, because he said, "Who can do anything after Beethoven?" So where does this leave us? How do we find a way in, as it were, beneath the surface of this legendary figure? As you were saying, Anne, this 250th Beethoven anniversary has been a catalyst to delve into the Met's collections in search of art of all shapes and sizes that gives us a sense of Beethoven's world and some of the forces that inspired him and shaped his music. The Met is particularly well-placed to explore some of the special properties of the palette of instruments that Beethoven had to work with. And I think it also helps to shine a light on our relationship with Beethoven today. This is often how we encounter Beethoven, up on a pedestal larger than life, with his rugged features and wild hair. In this bust, the sculptor Bordel is striving to capture personality and conjure up an atmosphere rather than create an exact likeness. This is a general hallmark of Romantic art that we'll return to later. This bust also reflects an approach to the telling of history that was emerging during the 19th century, which emphasized the veneration of the lone genius and the so-called great man theory that ascribed the trajectory of history to the actions of prominent individuals. This would have very much spoken to Bordel in creating this bust, which was one of at least 45 different likenesses of the composer that he made. In this light, it might be fair to say that Bordel was a bit obsessed with Beethoven. He fancied that he himself looked like Beethoven, and this fascination even had religious overtones. To Bordel, Beethoven was a Christ-like figure in that he embodied both God and man. Bordel gives voice to this godliness in the quote he chose for the pedestal of this bust. Beethoven was alleged to have proclaimed, "Me, I am Bacchus, who presses out delicious nectar for humanity." Beethoven's monumentality has become part of our popular imagination. How many of us learnt the piano with a plastic bust of Beethoven scowling at us? And even in our comic strips, when we think about Charlie Brown, there's Schroeder with a Beethoven bust on his piano. You probably also had one of these on your piano, a metronome. This mechanical device gives us an exact tempo for a piece of music. The one we see here is quite early, and it was made by Johann Mälzel, who introduced Beethoven to the metronome. This made him the first significant composer to utilize this new technology and to indicate metronome markings in his compositions, which you can see here in this very early edition of the Hammerklavier Sonata. Beethoven also gave unusually detailed directions about dynamics and articulations and other elements of interpretation and expression that would have typically been left to the discretion of the performer. Beethoven's use of the metronome and this very prescriptive instructions redefine the relationship between composer and performer. No longer is the performer an equal collaborative partner in contributing to the creation of a piece of music who would have been expected to improvise and to embellish, but instead the performer is there to faithfully reproduce exactly what is written in the score, to realize what music scholars call composer intent. So in giving Beethoven this first metronome, this relationship with Metzel is hugely impactful. Metzel also made hearing devices for Beethoven, and they had various other projects, but the most eye-grabbing product of their relationship was a commission for this rather unlikely looking instrument. This is the panharmonicon. It's basically a barrel organ with full-size wind instruments instead of pipes. You can imagine that it would have occupied a fairly large room from floor to ceiling. It's effectively a mechanical military band. You can see the wind instruments, clarinets, flutes, trumpets, horns. When we go around to the back, we find the percussion section, the bass drum, and the cymbals, the triangle, the bells, and the kettle drums. And down here, the whole thing was operated by a pinned barrel. And in that sense, it's an extension of the metronome and ensuring exact reproduction and ensuring composer intent, and that no musicians were needed at all for this performance, except for somebody to crank the handle. The title of the work that Metzel commissioned from Beethoven was Wellington's Victory, and we can see the action unfolding here. Wellington with his saber, we have the Prussian general Blücher with his blunderbuss, and here is Napoleon being toppled and his emperor's crown falling to the ground. Beethoven was initially a great admirer of Napoleon. Liberté, égalité, fraternité, the values of the French Revolution very much resonated with Beethoven. But he felt extremely disillusioned and personally betrayed when Napoleon declared himself emperor. This is when he scratched out the dedication to his third symphony and renamed it Eroica. The allegiance of Beethoven and many of his fellow countrymen shifted to Wellington. Wellington's Victory, which Beethoven also scored for orchestra, was designed to conjure up the battlefield with national anthems and percussion effects that emulated rifle and cannon fire. But it's fared poorly with our modern music critics, who dismiss it as being bombastic, crude, simplistic, and it's very seldom performed today. However, it was wildly popular during Beethoven's life, and it really spoke to people during an intensely fraught time when politics and questions of leadership permeated every aspect of daily life. And in our world of current events, it now becomes disconcertingly easier to understand the appeal of this work to Beethoven's audience. And I think we can appraise it in a much more visceral and knowing way. This commitment to the principles of liberty, equality, and universal brotherhood continued to shape Beethoven's work. As a key figure both of the Aufklärung, or German Enlightenment, and of Romanticism, another fundamental theme underpinning Beethoven's world was nature. To the Aufklärer, the natural world was a manifestation of scientific logic and truth, a microcosm of the universe that one could interact with and study. To the Romantic, nature and its contemplation were central to a reverence for beauty and a connection to the infinite. And for Beethoven, nature was sacred. More than any church or dogma, nature was Beethoven's religion. This landscape helps us to imagine the woods of Heiligenstadt on the outskirts of Vienna, which was Beethoven's favored retreat and place of sanctuary. It was a font of creative inspiration and an escape from the hubbub and noise of Vienna, which Beethoven felt was exacerbating his hearing loss. Beethoven declared, "My decree is to remain in the country. My unfortunate hearing does not plague me there. It is as if every tree spoke to me in the country. Holy, holy, heilig, heilig." Heiligenstadt is famously where Beethoven wrote his heart-wrenching Heiligenstadt Testament. In this unsent letter to his brothers, he divulges his deafness, its profound impact on his musical and personal life, and he contemplates suicide. With what must have been anguished longing, Beethoven wrote, "Surely woods, trees, and rocks produce the echo which man desires to hear." Beethoven's Pastoral Symphony offers an opportunity to hear how Beethoven gave voice to this echo. While we often think, perhaps somewhat dismissively, of the Sixth Symphony today as program music, for Beethoven it was undoubtedly a sacred work, perhaps even more so than overtly religious compositions like his Mass in C or Christ on the Mount of Olives. What are the instruments that Beethoven used to give this voice to nature? The orchestral instruments of his time differ significantly from those of ours. So let's start with the most familiar, the violin family. And the violin family instruments have changed the least. They would have had gut strings during Beethoven's time, which produced a warmer sound, a softer sound, and was much darker than our modern steel strings. There were different ways of holding these instruments. The chin rest didn't come into being until the 1820s, and there were subtle changes to the way the violin family instruments were set up. All these changes were designed to make them more robust and louder. And this starts to happen at the end of the 18th century. So during Beethoven's life, some players were using violins that were more or less as they were in the Baroque, like this instrument here. And other players were using instruments that had been modified to be very much like the violin as we know it today and as we see here. The wind instruments have changed profoundly. Woodwinds, the flute, the clarinet, the bassoon, had far fewer keys than they do today, and brass instruments like the trumpet and the horn had no valves. And what this means is that these wind instruments produced a subtly different tone killer from note to note when we play up and down the scale. And when we play these instruments in different keys, each one of those keys had a subtly different character or personality. And between the families of wind instruments, there was much more timbral variety. We hear subtle tonal inflections that are lost with our modern instruments. With all these instruments, in many cases, Beethoven was using them at the threshold of their capabilities in terms of range and volume. So when we play these passages on modern instruments, this tension and excitement of playing on the edge is lost. It's a bit too comfortable. It makes me think of riding down a country road in a sports car with the wind blowing through our hair, and we can feel every bump in that road. And if we go down the same road in a modern sedan, it's perfectly smooth, but we're cosseted from the road and from the sense of tension and excitement. It's almost too smooth in a sense. So for all these reasons, I am convinced that playing period instruments is the most visceral and immediate way into Beethoven's world. And it's particularly appropriate for the Pastoral Symphony and for helping us to enter into Beethoven's sacred space. Let's listen to a passage from the second movement of the Pastoral Symphony played on period instruments. We'll hear a series of bird calls. Beethoven may well have chosen these birds for their allegorical significance. First, we hear from the nightingale, which is emblematic of love, which was, of course, a frustrated leitmotif in Beethoven's life. Next is the quail, which represented providence, perhaps God in nature. And finally, the cuckoo, which typically warns against impending danger. There's a storm coming up in the next movement. So hear from the horn. In Beethoven's symphonies, horn parts are often reminiscent of the hunting horn or even the alp horn, but they are always transporting us to nature, to the woods, as in this call at the very close of the Sixth Symphony. Beethoven's symphonies transformed the genre, but his musical life began at the piano as a child prodigy, and it remains central to his world as a performer and composer. In this year of anniversaries, the Met's 150th and Beethoven's 250th, here's another one for you to think about. The 300th birthday of the world's oldest surviving piano, a crown jewel of the Met's collections. The piano first appeared around 1700, but because its sound was such a departure from the harpsichord, on which it was trying to improve with more expressive dynamic capability, it got off to a rather slow start. It was largely viewed as a technological novelty during the lifetime of its inventor, Bartolomeo Cristofori, and he died without having any idea that the instrument would be a success, let alone a global phenomenon. For this, the piano had to wait for the emotionally heightened aesthetics of Romanticism, and it comes into full flower nearly 100 years later in Beethoven's performing and writing. The Romantic era was the age of the piano, and Beethoven's lifetime was a period of change and development for the instrument. Beethoven owned pianos by a number of different makers. These two pianos are representative of the two contrasting types of instrument that Beethoven used. We have the Viennese piano, which had a light action and a crystalline clarity that is very well suited to the clean and agile virtuosity, and the English action, which is heavier but more powerful in sound and has more sustain. And it's the English action that becomes the basis for our modern grand piano. Beethoven's music, particularly his piano sonatas, invite us into an atmospheric world of contemplation, natural phenomena, and heightened emotion. Indeed, Beethoven is often mentioned in the same breath as Caspar David Friedrich, whose work epitomizes German romantic painting. With both, their focus was very much on capturing the essence and the atmosphere of a moment and drawing their audience into this world, as Friedrich does here, rather than offering an exact likeness of it. Atmospheric piano writing, of course, makes us think of Beethoven's Sonata No. 14, which he never called by its more famous name, the Moonlight Sonata. This title was given to it by the German poet Ludwig Rellstab 5 years after Beethoven's death. He likened the sense of motion and ambience evoked by Beethoven to a boat floating on moonlit Lake Geneva. The moon captured the imagination of artists of all stripes during the Romantic period, poets, painters, musicians. It represented serene contemplation, a sense of etherealness and otherworldliness, and we find it often depicted at twilight and partially obscured by clouds to capture the heightened beauty and sense of mystery of that which is veiled and hidden from full view. In this light, it's easy to understand how the sonata was given the very apt title of Moonlight. The Viennese piano of Beethoven's time that we're about to hear played with the pedal down to raise the dampers and allow the strings to vibrate freely throughout creates a wonderfully hazy atmosphere of contemplation. Another instrument that could perfectly express the romantic essence of veiled beauty and quietude was the horn of Beethoven's time. This has to do with the special technique that players used to perform a scale on the horn before valves were added to the instrument. And you can hear how this gives the horn a very veiled and soft sound, with each note sounding subtly different from its neighbor. Horn players figured out in the second half of the 18th century that you can produce a complete chromatic scale by placing your hand inside the bell of the instrument and closing it off to varying degrees. And that's actually changing the sounding length of the horn and thus altering the pitch of those open notes so that we can play chromatically. So as you can hear and see, the horn of Beethoven's time is very different from our modern instrument. His Ninth Symphony contains one of the most puzzling horn solos in the orchestral repertoire. Almost every note of this very prominent solo is produced with the special technique of closing off the bell with the hand. Such extensive use of hand stopping is atypical, and it was an effect that composers generally would have used more sparingly. Beethoven could have avoided this simply by pitching the horn in a different key, using one of the many crooks or interchangeable lengths of tubing that you see here. And it's odd because he also wrote the solo for the fourth horn, and this has caused scholars to speculate that the solo was written for the recently invented valve horn, and that the fourth horn player just happened to be in possession of this newfangled technology. For years, I was baffled by the solo and thought it was clumsy writing by a composer who really didn't think much about the horn. For the penny to drop, I had to wait until my career brought me to the Met. My eureka moment came when thinking about Caspar David Friedrich and the romantic aesthetic of quiet contemplation and the veiled and otherworldly moon, and putting these pieces together with Beethoven's romantic sensitivities as a composer. No other instrument in the orchestra was better placed to embody this than the horn, and I now understand that this solo is incredibly well thought out and just a very tender piece of horn writing, and I'm utterly convinced that Beethoven very deliberately wrote the solo for the horn without valves. You'll hear me play part of the solo first on the natural horn and then again on our modern instrument, while the sound and tone killer of the modern horn is bigger and as smooth as silk. The wonderfully soulful and veiled character of Beethoven's horn is lost, and I think the sound is rendered almost one-dimensional. Solo is just one of the many striking features of Beethoven's Ninth or Choral Symphony. The most exceptional is the inclusion of voices in a symphony, with Beethoven's articulation of Friedrich Schiller's famous poem, An die Freude, to joy. The poem was written on the brink of the French Revolution, and it had attracted Beethoven since he was a teenager. It expresses the idea of universal fellowship and brotherhood that Beethoven held so dear, and we hear it finally expressed in this famous chorus, an emblem of liberty and brotherhood that has resounded through time to become the anthem of the European Union, which was played at the fall of the Berlin Wall, which students sang in Tiananmen Square, and which continues to be an anthem of protest and hope around the world. Then, in the midst of this transcendent setting of Schiller's text, we hear something totally unexpected. As we continue to listen, this contrabassoon is joined by the other instruments representing the mater, or Turkish janissary band. The oboe and bassoon come in to complete the woodwind consort. We hear the piccolo and the flute and the trumpet. Of particular note, keep your ear out for the bass drum and the cymbals and the bells. These come into the European military band and the orchestra via the Ottoman Empire. emissary band marching through the Ninth Symphony. As unexpected as it is to our modern ears, there was a fascination in Europe during Beethoven's time in all things Turkish and in the Ottoman Empire. There was a growing curiosity with this other on the eastern border. In this Schellenbaum or bell tree, we have both a visual and audible representation of Turkey and the Orient, with the crescent moon, the pagoda-like forms, and the bells, all of which rattled when this instrument was carried on the march in a fashionable German or Austrian band. This rage for Türkülü permeated all aspects of art and culture, music as we've seen, but also in paintings and architecture, and even in this fashionable gentleman's smoking attire and Turkish-inspired clothing that was popular as far afield as America. Beethoven's inclusion of a Turkish march and the forces of a choir in the Ninth Symphony would have had a particular resonance to his audience because they were used to hearing music a la Turca and voices in the Turkish-themed operas that abounded during the 18th and 19th centuries. More specifically, it would have brought to mind Mozart's opera, The Abduction from the Seraglio, and it could be read in a sense as a reference to the universal brotherhood embodied in the plot of The Abduction, where the Pasha Selim foregoes seeking retribution on the son and friends of his greatest Western enemy, and instead frees them and releases their lover from the harem in the name of mercy and compassion. It is a powerful gesture of universal love and brotherhood that reaches across faiths and across the divide of East and West. This amplifies the universal brotherhood underpinning the Ninth Symphony and the embrace to all the world that Beethoven and Schiller offer up in the extraordinary finale of the Ninth Symphony. Beethoven's ideals still remain the stuff of revolutions, and I believe his power and unbounded originality in expressing them continue to speak truth to our times. So the final bit of music I'll leave you with is one where we hear one of Beethoven's most famous and popular piano pieces finding resonance with new genres, new artists, and new audiences. Well, that's an inspirational tune from rapper Nas, underpinned by Beethoven's piano piece Für Elisa. Thank you all so much for delving into the Metz collection with me to explore Beethoven, and many thanks to colleagues from across the museum for making this program possible.